Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the Mental Health Professional Network webinar, an interdisciplinary panel discussion on recognising, screening and assessing complex trauma. Now, tonight, I'm a disembodied voice. My name's Mary Emilias. I'm a GP in Cairns in far north Queensland. And unfortunately, I had some computer problems tonight and you can't see me. But you can see our esteemed panel, and the discussion is going to be just as useful as ever. So my apologies. The technology platform is fine. It's actually a problem at my end. So I'd like to acknowledge the support of the Adults Surviving Child Abuse organisation in the production of this webinar, which is presented jointly by ASCA and MHPN. And it was funded by the Commonwealth Department of Social Services to deliver this professional development series of three webinars. This is the second of three. And this is for practitioners who support individuals and communities affected by or engaging in the Royal Commission into Institutional Responses to Child Sexual Abuse. Now, I'd like to introduce to you tonight our panel. Dragan Wright is our consumer advocate this evening. Now, Dragan, I understand that you're based in Sydney, and as well as being a consumer advocate, you are yourself a psychotherapist and a teacher. What balance do you have at the moment between your training and your counselling work?
It's probably a bit of a 60-40 training heavy at the moment. There's been a lot of trauma-informed practice training being rolled out sort of nationally, so that's I've been doing a lot of that lately.
Thank you and welcome very much, and we look forward to hearing from you during our discussion. Now, Michelle, you're a clinical psychologist. And you're also involved in training, and I understand, are you also based in Sydney? What's it like there tonight?
It's unseasonably warm in Western Sydney, so I'm in the room that I've worked in all day, seeing people in Penrith, west of Sydney.
Thank you, Michelle, and it's a pleasure to have you with us. Now, Johanna, you're a GP as well with a special interest in mental health. What is it about the mental health work that made you kind of change direction a little bit in your general practice?
I was seeing a lot of people coming through my normal general practice. We joke about how women GPs see tears and sneers, and I see quite a few lots of tears, and realised that I didn't have the training I needed to care for those people well, and so that led me down a path of some training in grief and loss and trauma and attachment and ongoing research in the area too.
Thanks very much, Johanna. Now, I can hear on the audio somebody's breathing. It could be mine, but just if anyone's got the microphone very close to your mouth, you might want to just move it back a bit. And Adjunct Professor Warwick Middleton, who's a psychiatrist on our panel tonight. Now, Warwick, you're also very involved in training, and I noticed that you've had a particular interest in the field of trauma and dissociation for really, well, I understand you've been at the Trauma and Dissociation Unit. You helped establish that nearly 20 years ago, but I expect your interest in trauma dates back further than that. How did you become interested in that specifically as a psychiatrist?
Well, I always actually think that trauma is actually a core part of psychiatry. It's my conceptual framework is that it's not a special interest or a specialised area, but it's core psychiatry, and my overall perspective is that probably pound for pound, you know, how humans treat each other probably has more to do with the causation of mental illness than any other single factor. So it's always been a core central issue.
Thanks very much, Warwick, and we look forward to your expertise in our panel discussion as well. Now, just a few very basic ground rules before we get started. Just remember that everyone, we're sharing a shared space. There are hundreds of participants on that line, and shortly I'll be able to tell you how many. We had over 2,000 registrants, which is a record for an MHPN webinar, and it just shows how interested people are in this topic. So just remember that other participants and panellists can see what you're writing in the chat box. That can be extremely helpful for the discussion between the participants. And so just treat it as though it were a face-to-face activity. You're welcome to post comments and questions into the general chat box, and I and the panellists will keep an eye on that. If you have a technical problem, go into the technical help chat box, and just remembering that the comments can be seen by everyone. And when we finish, your feedback's really important, so please complete the short exit survey, which will appear as a pop-up when you exit the webinar, and MHPN certainly takes notice of your feedback with regard to technical issues, panelists, and topics for future discussion. So you've all read the case study beforehand, and this was the second episode in our story of Tanya, who is 36 and presents with some things suggestive of a background of complex trauma. And in tonight's edition, she's presenting to the psychologist for the first time. So tonight we're really focusing on assessment and engaging, helping someone feel comfortable. So the learning objectives for tonight is to understand the prevalence, epidemiology, characteristics and impacts of complex trauma. Actually, just a technical thing, I'm assuming that someone else is advancing the slides for me. Thank you, MHPN. We also hope to be better equipped to recognise, screen and assess the physical, mental and psychosocial presentations which might indicate unresolved trauma. And we're hoping to give you some take-home tips and strategies for interdisciplinary collaboration to screen, recognise and assess people who have been exposed to or experienced complex trauma. So without further ado, I hope that I will appear on camera at some stage this evening, but I am here on the phone. And so I would like to welcome Dragan to present the consumer advocate perspective, thinking about some of the things that Tanya might be experiencing as she presents to this first appointment. So over to you, Dragan. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Mary. Okay, so from a consumer perspective, obviously, Tanya could be experiencing quite high anxiety even coming into the meeting. She's come in, she says, ostensibly just because her doctor, suggested it. So we don't know if she has a high investment in meeting with the practitioner, but I'm imagining there'd be high anxiety, a hypervigilance around, what do you think of me? Like, there can be a real feeling of, I don't really, even walking into a clinic or into a reception area, into the actual room, a real feeling of, what do you think of me? Do I even belong here? Is there anything here for me at all? Maybe I'm just, going through the motions or going through the system, or maybe I think that's what I'm doing, but actually I am wanting support, I'm wanting something, because she's turned up, yeah? So on the slides you'll see I've put at the bottom sort of the practitioner viewpoint, if you like, so very much essential to stay in that very open, non-judgmental place, because there will be that hypervigilance to being perceived. For myself, I even remember, that I felt the way I dressed wasn't right, or the way, I wouldn't feel professional enough coming into places. I'd feel there was a real gap between me and the professional. So all of that stuff is going to be going on, even around, what I look like in my dress, or on the earlier case study, she smelt highly of tobacco and stuff. So she may be aware of those things for herself with how she presents in the world, and some of that might be protective, that's often something that happens. We might be heavily tattooed, might be wear our clothes in a certain way, might these things might be protective things as well. So very much that non-judgmental place, and recognizing that as a practitioner, you do hold the power in that moment. There is that power differential. Someone coming in for support is coming into somebody else's system, somebody else's service. And so that idea of the dominant paradigm, again, do I even belong here? Is there anything for me here? Especially when you get into, culture and multiculturalism, whether that's ethnic culture, whether it's gender, sexuality culture, it can be very, very sort of separating to come in and not feel that you're represented in any way. So as much as possible as a practitioner, it's wanting to equalize that power differential as much as we can. All the joining things, someone, never underestimate the therapeutic benefits of a cup of tea, like those sorts of things. Like, John Breer talks very much about we're all bozos on the same bus, you know, that we're holding that kind of point of view as a practitioner. This is moving away from us and them. This is moving into, okay, we're all in this boat. And as a consumer, if I feel the practitioner is trying to get on the same ground, that's going to enable me to then join with them. So safety first, trauma-informed practice, very much it's all about safety, it's all about relationship building. Tanya does blurt out a number of things, but she's not going to really connect and really talk about what's going on for her until she feels safe enough. And that's going to be safety relationally, that's going to be safety in the environment, whether she even feels comfortable coming into this practice, what that's like for her coming into the practice, the environment itself, whether it feels like an institutional thing, whether it feels welcoming, whether it's comfortable for her. She's a very abrasive, I suppose, in a way, in the way that she's approaching the reception, in the way that she's complaining and things like that. That's probably, again, another coping strategy on keeping herself safe. So safety is, okay, recognizing that people's strategies or behavioural mannerisms could very well be protective, and most likely someone's going to be experiencing high anxiety and fear. You know, that's what a lot of these things are obviously covering up, a high degree of fear. Coming into contact with people, you know, we're talking interpersonal trauma when we're talking about complex trauma. So people can be the dangerous ground. People can be, the relationship itself can be what's highly feared by somebody. So this slide is referring to the fact that often as a consumer, or, you know, we know that we can be erratic. Like, we know that we may not feel in control of our emotional state, or that we may dysregulate. And there can be even more shame sort of compounded with that, sort of knowing I don't feel in control of my own self. I'm aware that I can get snappy, or I'm aware that I can give the receptionist a hard time, or I'm aware that I can just disappear and not be able to engage at all. Often consumers are aware of that, but don't feel any control around that. And so creating safety, like an intrapersonal sense of safety, is that we are doing some of that very basic sort of tool sharing around regulation, around the window of tolerance, which I think Michelle is going to talk about after. But we are using those to help someone learn how to regulate, how to stay present, how to downregulate if they're getting very, very sort of hyper aroused. And that's part of our job, and it's very simple, even just very simple things that we can do, and it can, again, help someone feel more empowered, can help them feel more able to even be there. But it has to be given in a way that isn't going to create more shame. And just the last slide that I've got here is just the idea that, she's here, you know, for whatever reason she's here. Maybe she's just here because the doctor said. Maybe she actually has some hope that this might be useful for her. Maybe she does want to connect with somebody, and maybe she does want some support, but she may resist that. She may fight it. She may over-attach. You know, there's all the attachment stuff that can be played out relationally. It can be avoidant. You know, it could be manipulative. All sorts of things will happen in the room. But the person is there. They've come. And our job as a practitioner is just even sitting with that and building that relationship in the moment, and understanding that all of those fears and anxieties could be playing out, and a lot of those relational strategies could be playing out, and the expectations, the wonderings of what are we as a practitioner going to provide, what does this even mean? People can come into these situations not even knowing how to be, not knowing what's expected of them. And again, it's I'm referring to John Breer again. He talks very much about the organic movement towards health, towards well-being, that there is something inside us that does want that and does reach for that. And I think that's what Tanya is also doing somewhere in there as well. And as a practitioner, there's a great opportunity to join with her in that moment and maybe create even a threat for her to be able to come back to that, So we do often, as a practitioner, have to hold the hope, hold the optimism that recovery is absolutely possible for people. I think that's it.
Thank you very much, Tigran. And I really like your pictures.
Thank you.
Now, Michelle, I would like to invite you to respond to Tanya, as she might be the kind of person that would come and see you as a psychologist. Thanks very much.
Sure. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Good-o. My initial thoughts were I really wanted to recognise that she made it in the room. So picking up on what where Dragan had left off, acknowledging that there's some risk for her potentially in meeting with somebody with perceived power and her perceptions about having a head read, and she is taking a risk. So what's it taken for her to do that? But also the real skills and abilities that she's relied on to in the chaos of her life to make it here. 10 minutes is nothing. 10 minutes later is nothing in the context of Tanya's life. So appreciate that she's made it. And for this highlights for me the importance of having a trauma-informed context. It's not enough that we do what we do behind the door in the therapy room. The practice has to be accessible and set up to reflect trauma-informed values. So the kinds of strategies in a practice that would be experienced as pleasant by most people I think are really critical for trauma survivors, extra sensitive to those interpersonal cues of being disapproved of or not belonging. So making sure that services are warm enough, so boundaried warmth, and provide people with a welcome, never a rebuke at the reception desk, and a cup of tea is offered, and is genuinely offered, is offered each time somebody walks in the door, that there is a place for them here. I would wanting to be to recognise that the barriers to Tanya seeking this kind of help are real, and not pathologising Tanya at all in that regard, that she's found it difficult to connect and to find the right service, to find the right person. This may not be the one either, but the barriers to help for her are real, and services can own some of those barriers. It's not all about Tanya either. So I'd not only accept her apparent ambivalence to seeking help, but to embrace it, really. It makes sense that she'd be finding it hard, difficult to trust people. She probably, her life experience has been she does need to be wary of others and to understand her ambivalence in that context, but extend that acceptance to recognising and respecting any of her adaptations to trauma as having had some survival utility, as making sense for her either at the time or in the context of her life experience. So when she says things like, who blame her, regarding her mother's drinking, you know, taking that as an opportunity also to recognise and validate that these are her adaptations to trauma. And like blokes do, so minimising the sexual abuse she'd experienced, respecting that minimising as a coping strategy. So an initial meeting assessment and thereafter taking extra care that nothing we do clinically resembles a doing to Tanya that I'd expect that she would find that triggering, and I'd take extra care not to do to Tanya. In the initial session, I'd be focusing much more on process than content. So taking opportunities to validate her connections, how would you behave? I guess you're making the helping, supporting her connections between past and present, or between experience and emotional experience. We know enough of the story to know that she's being impacted by multiple trauma and loss, and resist my own temptation to want to get the story and get the facts, but actually respect her boundaries and limits about what she doesn't want to talk about and her fears about having a head read. So keeping the focus on process in the session. From the case, the write-up, we were given dissociation appears likely, and I think it's important that we can roll with those changes in state, that we don't become disoriented and disturbed or confused about what's happening for her, that we stay steady and accept any need for repetition or reorienting statements and support her efforts to self-soothe and self-regulate. So I'd have something like this in my mind, I guess a graph alternating between the top and down to the bottom. So recognising hypervigilant or highly emotionally reactive states, but also recognising as stress responses and fear responses, the hyper-aroused or withdrawn or numb states, and supporting her efforts to regulate that, knowing that eventually we'll be looking for that window of tolerance where her cognitive processing and connecting thoughts, emotions, sensations is going to be better in that central zone, but that may be hard for her to stay in, and hard to recognise, at least initially. So not trying to move her from either of those states, but support her movement from either hyper-aroused or hypo-aroused states. So in terms of a formal assessment, I'd be putting aside pen and paper, at least for now, and certainly no formal tick box assessments. Anything I did write down would be visible to Tanya, as it generally is anyway. I'd make this a really transparent process. If anything, systematically, I'd be thinking about her strengths more as a lens for me to make sure that I'm keeping an eye on what is going well in her life. There's certainly a lot of terrible things that have happened and a lot of terrible things continuing to happen, but I'd be wanting to systematically think about what's going well, who are the people in her life that are safe, the safe relationships or validating relationships. Thinking about how does she cope with the little things that go wrong are often revealing of the big things. So what are her strategies, what are her capacities to self-soothe, and how is she managing that? So not evaluating them as good, bad or otherwise, but just understanding how they're working for her. So any diagnostic assessment I'd be holding pretty lightly, and that's current and past diagnoses that she may bring with her, and be honest with myself and with Tanya about the limitations or benefits of a diagnosis that might apply. It's likely that many diagnoses might apply. Just some research that I thought spoke to some of Tanya's experience. This paper by Rees. Three or more forms of gender-based violence increase the risk of a serious mental health problem by 11 times. I think it was 90% of the women in this study who'd experienced three or more forms of gender-based violence had a diagnosis of a serious mental health problem. From the adverse childhood experiences studies, an ACE score, so four or more categories of adversity in childhood, which Tanya certainly meets and exceeds, they're 46 times more likely to attempt suicide than people with an ACE score of zero. The odds ratio, so quoted in the final piece here, developing a range of disorders are very much higher for those who've experienced childhood sexual abuse, including psychosis. So it's likely that she'd met the criteria for multiple diagnoses. Cumulative trauma symptoms are going to be more complex and just less likely to fit any one sort of diagnostic criteria neatly. So by the end of the first session, I've got some immediate decisions to make, I think, regarding her request not to tell the GP about the doctor shopping and medication. I'd actually also see the doctor shopping in some way as it's resourcefulness. She's doing what she needs to do and she's making some choices about what she needs to manage her experiences. But her request not to tell the GP, I'd be thinking about, and I'd also be thinking about how to address the self-harm that we haven't addressed directly in the session, but now I've seen, and she knows I've seen, we've connected over that, if I'm the psychologist in the case study. I'd make it clear, at least from my point of view, that it's her decision to come back, but I'm offering a place where she won't be judged and she'll never be in trouble. And she'll be treated as an adult woman with courtesy and respect. I'd also be thinking pretty quickly, hi, Mary. About I can see Mary on the video, which is a good sign, supporting the GP, I'd want to recognise that Tanya's been a patient of that same practice for 16 years, which says something about the way that practice operates and also Tanya's capacity for sort of development of that relationship over time. So I'd also view those as strengths. And then I guess I'd be left thinking about what she needs from me in the immediate term, support for emotional regulation, those sorts of skills Dragan was talking about, her awareness of triggers, how I can support her growing awareness of those, managing intrusive experience or dissociation, but also quite likely, I think, some immediate attention to her understanding of her relationship with children, so her distress at them not needing her anymore, and I think some immediate attention to actually reframing her role as a mother, as them needing to adult children, as children emerging to adulthood, certainly very much needed, but in a different way. So thinking about ways to help preserve and support those relationships in her life before we move forward.
Thank you very much, Michelle. And I am now on camera and online. So my apologies for the difficulties at the beginning. It was an issue at my end. There are 650 participants online. So welcome, everybody. Now we know how many of you there are. And so I'd like now to hand over to Johanna, who I'm quite sure was pleased to hear that Michelle, as a psychologist, would be keeping the GP in mind. Johanna.
Yes, I was. I thought that was a very sensitive psychologist there, Michelle, noticing the long-standing relationship with the practice. And I guess I'm coming in speaking as a primary care practitioner who sees trauma in our community, but also to acknowledge that there's trauma amongst our healthcare community as well. And I think that, again, reminds us of the humanity of what we're dealing with and of its prevalence. Of course, this is a really overt case, and it's partly that way to teach us, but I'm hoping that we'll also be absorbing some subtleties as well about how to care for the less obvious trauma victims amongst our client base and in our midst. ASCA would say there's up to 4 million Australians, adult Australians, who are survivors of childhood trauma and neglect. And so that's a large part of any day-to-day primary care work. And I'm sure many of you who are listening have seen that face-to-face in the work that you've done. I just thought I would bring in the idea of preparing myself, my own self and heart for seeing Tanya and being really...
Johanna, can I just get you to move your microphone a tiny bit closer?
Yeah, I'll try doing that. Is that better?
That's great. Thank you.
Yeah, just being really aware of the countertransference or almost the neurology that's going on between her and myself when we meet. I'm already aware that some of that's been sparked at the front desk. And there's a sense of Tanya arriving almost with a vibe that I may absorb and react to without even being aware that I'm doing it. And one of the clear vibes that I sense in her story is hopelessness. And this is something I sometimes think of as an experience she's had since childhood and that comes with her as she travels through life, and that we can absorb and start to treat her as though she's hopeless if we're not careful. At the moment, I think we're at a key time in mental health history where we can actually be saying with confidence that she does have some hope and that there are treatment options available to her in our community that could give her hope. The other key thing that I notice in her relationship is ambivalence towards the practitioner and towards key figures in her life story. And again, that's something to be really aware of the pull in both directions, to reject her or over-involve with her and even join in with secret keeping or those kind of things that she's asked for. In general practice, we sometimes talk about heart sink dread when we have a case that makes our heart sink when we're thinking of seeing them when they're on the list for the day. And again, I think that's a really key thing for us to notice in our own bodies that will help us to prepare for seeing her when she comes into the room. And it's something we need to actively manage, to not just let it push us around, but to actively hold her in mind as we're managing ourselves.
Johanna,
yes?
I'm just aware of the time, and you've got some fantastic things on the rest of your slides. So I was wondering if you'd be able to just quickly go over them without
yes.
too much explanation.
That's great.
Because
That's
there will
fine.
Be chance
Can
in the discussion for that. Thank you.
Can you still hear me? Oh, that's way better.
That's much better.
I just wanted to mention affect regulation as well as a key thing which Michelle's mentioned, and then the concept of coherence, that we're trying to hold this person coherently, and that's an active almost antidote to some of the splitting and disconnection she has within herself and with other relationships. And I would see that as holding myself as well as holding her as a whole person, her present history, her context and history, her body and her mind, as well as the things she's bringing with her and the things she's not bringing with her that I need to keep in mind. And again, the system can become something that's not coherent. Some of these slides I've intentionally put here for you to read later. This is one about making sure that we prioritize safety instead of the history taking, which can sometimes happen in practice. Again, this is a slide, my conceptions of how I think about safety in someone's social setting, their relationships, their body, their mind, their emotions, their sense of self, and even their spirit. And I would see in Tanya that she has had things that we can notice in this story in each of those areas. This is an and adapted from Christine Courtois' Complex Traumatic Stress Disorders from 2009. And she just notices the things that complex trauma alters in a person. And we'd see this in Tanya's story. She's using things to self-soothe, including medications. She has the moments of disconnection with herself and has gone still and vague in front of us, so attention and consciousness has been altered. Her perception of herself, she talks about feeling nothing without her children. Her perceptions of the perpetrators in her life, that she idealizes her mother and has mixed feelings towards the other people in the story. Her relationships with others, she's really experienced abandonment at multiple levels. Her connection with her body, which again has been a little bit hinted in the multiple visits to the doctor. And then changes in her system of meaning. She says, nothing good ever lasts for me. I've made a slide there about some key notes on what dissociation is. And those are just for your information to read later. And then this is just my hopes for her. My hope is that Tanya will be listened to with safe connection, that she'll grow in hope and power, that she'll be taught to be less phobic of her emotions and be confident to soothe her own levels of arousal, that she'll understand the triggers she experiences, she'll begin to see the relational patterns that are happening around her and between her and others, that she'll start to notice all of herself and learn to be kind and caring, including intrapsychic ways she talks to herself. She'll engage other help, and that includes practical things like where she's going to live and her workplace, of course, and that she'll be helped by a team that collaborates, that actively works against dissociation of the system. That would be my hopes for Tanya.
Thank you very much, Joanna. Now I'll just ask you to mute your microphone, and I apologise for rushing you through. I've
that's
also had my internet
all right.
My internet connection has dropped out again and my camera's disappeared, so I'm still here. Now, I would like to welcome Warwick to speak to us about how he might respond to this as a psychiatrist. And Warwick, bearing in mind there's also a lot of great material in your slides, I wonder if you would mind just basically
I'll be brief, Mary.
Quick overview, yeah, and then we can get on to the discussion. Thank you.
Look, thanks, Mary. Look, I was going to just briefly offer a somewhat different perspective. Society and psychiatry for over a century has been periodically grappling, sometimes with some intensity and sometimes not, with the issues that cause sorts of complex syndromes represented by Tanya. Complex trauma reflects a type of trauma where a person in a relatively inescapable situation is repeatedly exposed to trauma and frequently at the hands of people that would normally be their caregivers. Whilst in our society it's mainly based around ongoing child abuse, physical, sexual, emotional abuse, in other contexts it includes scenarios such as child soldiers, sex trafficking, slavery, etc. At the more severe end of the complex trauma syndrome are those individuals who have been dissociating from a very early age as a way of compartmentalizing and other the affects and memories of ongoing trauma. It's one way of surviving when there's very little by way of escape or alternatives. Some years ago, I published with a colleague a naturalistic study on 62 patients who fulfilled diagnostic criteria for DID, dissociative identity disorder, and I'll just briefly highlight a few points that arose out of that because it epitomises the fact that these individuals would, if a DSM is applied to them, satisfy typically 10 or 12 different diagnostic entities. And the whole concept of complex trauma revolves around the fact that you can either say that this person's got multiple diagnoses or that they actually have a complex symptomatology that is associated with something that affects most aspects of their life, belief systems, and sense of self. And in our group, of 62, it's very obvious that these are at the serious end of the mental health spectrum, but also epitomises the reality that a lot of them end up with diagnoses that have got nothing to do with trauma. Like nearly a third of ours had a diagnosis at some stage of schizophrenia, and 20% had, without fulfilling diagnostic criteria, had been given at some stage a diagnosis of mania. Naturally, most of them are depressed, but most of them also are very prone to somatize. One of the reasons that the concept of complex PTSD or disorders of extreme stress not otherwise specified sort of took off was it was a way of avoiding what was seen as the stigmatization that went with the diagnosis of borderline personality disorder. And as you can see, people in the highly dissociative end frequently fulfill criteria for borderlines, and if you took a population of borderline personality disorder patients, you'll find that they are highly dissociative, but they're not exactly the same, but they're two overlapping groups. These people are more likely to have Schneiderian first rank symptoms than people with schizophrenia, and befitting their dissociation, they have a high dissociation score. I mentioned briefly the history of conceptualizing people such as Tanya involved building a model around complex trauma that incorporated a number of affects. There was a recognition of the fact that these people's affect is very unregulated, that they're prone to depression, to anger, to suicidality, to impulsive sexual engagement at times, that they dissociate, that they're prone to somatization, and the majority of people in that group fulfill criteria for somatization disorder. They are locked into a relationship frequently with perpetrators, suffer long-standing shame, and this impacts so deeply that it affects their entire concept of what life is about and their sense of meaning and worth. The discourse that we've been having, and I'm not going to dwell on this, is one in which, you know, in the late 19th century, there was serious examination of hysteria, which then faded, which then the people in the spectrum largely got subsumed by a broadening of the concept of schizophrenia. And any real focus on dissociative conditions, complex trauma, was very much underemphasized until the late 70s, when incest arose out of an environment where the symptomatology and course of Vietnam veterans actually gave impetus to the plight of those many other people in society who suffered complex trauma syndromes. And slowly, little by little, the battered baby, the shaken baby syndrome became accepted, as did the reality of the high level of sexual abuse in children. And it's an interesting concept when we look at Tanya, that to think that a lot of research would indicate that the commonest age at which a child begins to be sexually abused is about the age of 3. So these people frequently arrive, in adulthood having been sexually abused for most of their childhood. And in recent years, it's become apparent that some of them, a subgroup, are actually continue to be the victims of ongoing incest into their adult years, and these are the victims of the sort of the Joseph Fritzls of the world. Also, in this world, in recent years, we've become much more focused on the issues of political or organized abuse, such that the victims of intrafamilial abuse are also frequently very vulnerable to being abused in groupings of pedophiles, in politically powerful groups, in church groups, and it's very interesting that at this point in time that our society has embarked on something more wide-ranging in this area than anyone has ever attempted, and that's the Royal Commission, which in our particular case has a frame of reference that hasn't been equal previously in human interaction with this issue. And I guess it's only in this year that we've actually had the United Nations demand that the Vatican immediately remove all clergy who are known or suspected child abusers and turn them over to authorities. It would have been unthinkable a few years ago. And this is the world that Tanya is now being assessed in. So all of the things that Michelle and others have said, totally agree with. She needs care, respect, and and to be made welcome. The most fundamental thing that you can actually do in regard to an individual is to actually listen. So I'll leave it at that.
Thanks very much, Warwick.
Just one last thought.
Yeah, sure.
It's a quote from a humorist, I suspect, but it goes on the lines of never try to teach a pig to sing, it wastes your time and annoys the pig. Probably the best thing that we can do for individuals such as Tonya, as a community of health professionals, is to do the best research possible, to do the best clinical work possible, to publish in as mainstream journals as possible. It's a complete waste of time to try and convince people of things that they don't want to know. But there are many people who work in this field who begin to actually get it, to hear the music, if you like, of what it's like to be chronically traumatized, and realize that all of those people that in the past were diagnosed with hysteria or unusual forms of schizophrenia actually had another explanation, and it lay with usually the intrafamilial abuse of children. So leave it with you.
Thanks, Warwick. Actually, I wanted to just ask you to follow up by asking, I think I'll get you to pose the question to Dragan, but with the complexity of some of the clients that we see, sometimes therapists and clinicians can develop an almost sort of nihilistic view, and I know that you had a question about that. So I just wondered if you wanted to pose that to Dragan.
Yeah, and it goes along the lines. It's the observation that from time to time, in respect to a challenging patient with a complex trauma syndrome, one may hear a colleague say something along the lines of, well, you can't save them all, you know. What does this comment mean, and how does one respond? And I'd be very interested in Dragan's thoughts.
Mm. I think as a consumer, you're aware of that too. You're aware of practitioners thinking you're a hopeless case, and one may feel that oneself, you know, that there's no real hope for me, no one's really going to be able to help me. I think because complex trauma is, you know, recovery is not a nice linear path, and people can appear to go backwards before they go forwards, or, you know, people can do both. It's more of a, I don't know, it's a spiral or a whole messy jumble of journey. I think it's really, really important as a consumer to feel that the practitioner does have hope that we can recover, even when it looks pretty rough, pretty hard. I think that's just essential, because often consumers themselves feel hopeless, feel like, can't save them all, not going to be able to save me, no one's been able to so far, what makes you any different? It's often a very bleak place to be, so I think it's our job to hold the optimism, you know, even while knowing it's challenging. Not everyone makes it, whatever that means. You know, recovery is a journey according to what that is for that person.
Thanks, Dragan. So it's been, and I guess you're speaking from experience too, that it's been really important to have clinicians who hold on to that belief.
Yeah.
That you're not beyond help. Now, Dragan, you had a couple of interesting questions as well, and I was particularly, in the case study, the psychologist noticed that Tanya had some fresh self-harm scars that she hadn't mentioned, and she noticed the psychologist noticed them. Now, I wondered if you wanted to address your question about that to Michelle.
Yeah, Michelle. My question's around having noticed the scars, because we're wanting to work with what's present in the room, although it's very early days, obviously it's the first meeting, but what do you think around just speaking to what's there? Like, how would you deal with that? You've seen them, she knows you've seen them. Is there anything one could say before she has to bolt?
Yeah, thanks, Dragan. I mean, I'd really hope that at the end of the session she's not bolting, so I'm already wanting to rewrite that and hope that I've slowed things down and made things safer so that she's not needing to bolt. I've noticed some older scars on her legs, and I think when we're talking about how you deal with distress, I might have framed a question about that earlier anyway. Now that I've seen it, I probably wouldn't pin her down and get her to stay. I'd be, you know, verbally, I'd be respecting the fact that she needed to leave. But I certainly wouldn't ignore it the next time, and hope we get another chance to talk about it. I think that's part of working in this way as well. You really don't know if you're going to get another chance to be with a person and recognise something. So taking the opportunities when they're there, whilst keeping in mind and keeping in balance, how safe is it for the person? Do they feel safe enough to talk about this? So briefly, if I asked about the self-harm, I would have prefaced it with a statement of lots of people, we do anything we can to manage ourselves and manage distress, and many people even talk about harming their bodies and using that as a way to manage distress. Does that make any sense to you?
And Michelle, you had a question for Dragan about shame, and I think this is probably an appropriate point to bring it up, because I suppose one of the reasons Tanya is not wanting to make a thing about her fresh scars, and that you've understood, is that she may in fact be feeling shame about that. So you had something that you wanted to ask. Well, I thought you could ask Dragan.
No, sure. I was hearing what Dragan had said, which is an important perspective about how much shame and vulnerability people might feel in that first session. And I just wanted to hear from you, what do you think the most important things are that we can offer to not provoke further shame, but to provide an environment where shame might be reduced and certainly not provoked further.
Yeah, I mean, I'm quite an advocate of appropriate psychoeducation, really, because that in itself, like, knowledge is power and understanding, and so understanding what's happening within one's own system can help minimise shame. Understanding, you know, that feeling of feeling out of control, getting triggered, etc., understanding that it's, you know, your sympathetic nervous system response. But, you know, using appropriate language to help people really understand and thereby have some sense of empowerment around what's happening, because once we, you know something, we can start to do something about it. I think that's one way that shame can be start to be diminished. I'm normal, you know. I'm not just some freaky out of control person. So also, I guess, you know, there's, again, using, I don't like the word normal, but there's that sort of normalizing of somebody's experience. Maybe, you know, the understanding that they're not alone. People often feel very isolated, feel like they're the only person it's happened to. So, you know, some ways of bringing that information out, that they're absolutely not alone, that that you do have some understanding of where they're coming from, while obviously not being able to know where they're coming from, but ways to just try and join and bring it out to more of a human experience rather than their very own sort of very small, isolated experience.
Yeah, Mary, could I jump in there?
Yeah, look, I was going to invite you in now anyway, so that's great.
Good. I was just thinking of something that I find myself doing in that psychoeducation space, Dragan, where I talk about how normal it is for children to feel shame, and why. You know, I sort of use a couple of frameworks there to talk about why shame becomes normal. I talk about magical thinking in children, that they think that things that happen in the world are because of them. So when things go well, they think they caused that. And similarly, when things don't go well, they think they're the cause of that. But also issues around powerlessness, that the experience of powerlessness for a human is excruciating. And that is the experience of a child who's experiencing right the way all different types of abuse, including neglect, that they're powerless to change what the adults around them are doing. But the experience of blaming oneself is a way of giving yourself some power, because you did have power, but you obviously used it wrongly, and therefore we're not able to prevent what happened. And so I quite consciously bring up in with my patients that part of getting better in trauma is being able to tolerate knowing that you were powerless. And the other area is the area of connection, that for children to be connected to their perpetrator is often a real double bind, that they're drawn to connect and want to connect to their perpetrator, and therefore if they can see that the perpetrator was the cause, that increases their double bind. And so one way of relieving that is to say that they were the cause and that the perpetrator was not to blame. And so part of getting better again is to learn to tolerate ambivalence towards our perpetrators, because and often those perpetrators were kind and good and loving sometimes, and that was genuine and real, and at the same time they were horrendous and frightening and bring up all sorts of feelings of revulsion and anger in the child. And just learning that that is part of getting better in trauma is then makes it really not about shame that, that something was wrong with them. I don't know if that's of any help.
Thank you. And I wanted actually also the two of you just to discuss the issue about Tanya had disclosed something to the psychologist that she didn't want her to tell the doctor. So, Dragan, I think you actually posed the question on that. So I was just wondering if you had thoughts on it or if you wanted to just speak with Johanna about that.
Yeah, look, I mean, that's a tricky one, eh? From a consumer perspective, I would totally understand that, her asking, don't tell the doc. But from a professional point of view, there may be a professional responsibility in there. So I'm actually interested in what the other panelists have to say on that.
We'll go to Johanna and then perhaps Michelle.
Yeah, sure.
Yes, I kind of think I'm being invited into some secret keeping there, and my alarm bells would be going off as to how to make sure she still feels safe while yet not sort of colluding with her in secret keeping, because secret keeping is often so rife in the relationships that have patterns. So the way I would normally solve that is that I would ask them if they minded if I wrote a letter, which they then checked, and then together I would get her consent to send that letter. So that's how I would normally solve that problem. But I've become quite clear about that, having made a mistake or two earlier where I got agreed to that. And it then put me in the position of being quite professionally isolated and of undermining the care she was receiving from another professional.
And I guess what you...
Really practical tip. Dragan, sorry.
Sorry. I just wanted to follow on from what Joanna said, because she's setting the boundary but doing it again in a very respectful relational kind of way. You're getting collaboration with it, you're alongside again, you're not doing two. That's the difference in that approach, isn't it?
Yeah, and I guess there would be a little bit of checking too if there was something about this particular GP that made them feel unsafe. So to actually use that language and actually start the process of teaching them about assessing relationships for their quality of safety.
Thank you. And Michelle, I wondered if you've had experience or thoughts on addressing that issue when you are asked to keep a secret.
No, I agree with Johanna about not being, not colluding in secret keeping, so actually making it clear to Tanya that I think it's regarding the doctor shopping, isn't it, and her looking for other medications to help manage herself. And so validate, it's totally legitimate that she does what she can to feel better, but also profess my own ignorance. I'm not sure how these drugs are going to be working together for you, and is there any way I can support you to be having this open conversation with your GP about what you need medication to do for you and how it might work better for you. So I agree with if it's writing a letter, that the letter's open, that the person always has a copy of that letter. Does she need my support to have that open conversation with the GP? And place her at the centre of that. It's her life. They're the drugs that she's using. How can she use us better as resources in an open way to access what she needs?
Thanks, Michelle. And I'd like to bring Warwick back in. And Michelle, you had a question about, so far we've been focusing on helping this person to feel comfortable and safety issues. And then you had a question about formal assessment and diagnosis, which I think would be really good to ask Warwick, if that's okay.
Sure. I half wanted to ask a question because I suspected it would be coming up in the general chat, and it is, about assessment tools, et cetera. So, Warwick, I guess I wanted to ask you a question. If Tanya was admitted to your trauma and dissociation unit, how much weight do you put on diagnosis, whether the current system or the just retired system?
Obviously diagnosis is important, and it's really important that people in this spectrum don't end up with a diagnosis that's pretty unhelpful, or unfortunately occasionally end up with a diagnosis that you used in somewhat pejorative way, which is then becomes a rationalisation for failure or therapeutic nihilism. And I guess in the past, you know, when I was training, we used to hear things like, you know, the best form of treatment for borderlines is to refer them, which is a very pejorative way of putting it, and that was one of the impetus, I guess, for the whole concept of complex trauma as a way of getting... And I don't know what it is about mental health that when we get to complex trauma-like syndromes, we so frequently end up with descriptors or terminology that doesn't sound terribly inviting, like borderline, hysteria, histrionic, etc. And in terms of assessment, what I would do is, over however long it takes, take a full history, do the things that we're trained to do. But I would also ask a lot of questions about things that may not have been part of the traditional assessment interview that I might have been taught as a registrar. You know, I would be interested in dissociation, whether there are loss of time, absences of place, whether she finds herself in unusual places and can't remember how she got there, whether she finds things in other handwritings, what actually does go on, because we know that she seems to have some sort of affective change that happens pretty quickly, and you know what is she experiencing during those. One can augment that sort of assessment by using some instruments. One that's commonly and easily used is the dissociative experience scale, which takes, you know, 5-10 minutes to complete, and which gives you some idea about just the general level of dissociation a person has. It's not a diagnostic instrument. There are lots of other instruments that if one has to pursue that, you know, for some medico-legal reason, that one could, you know, the dissociative disorders interview schedule prepared by Colin Ross, there, you know, which addresses, I guess, a lot of the multiple diagnostic entities that coalesce in complex trauma: the somatization, the depression, the suicidality, the self-harm, the dissociation, anxiety. But the one thing it probably doesn't address much is the classic PTSD. And the difference between complex trauma and PTSD is that complex trauma usually incorporates PTSD, but has so much more, as we know, about, you know, how one perceives oneself, about not having a sense of self. And we also get that sense with Tanya. She doesn't have a very centered self at all. And it's picked up in the sort of things she does. She tends to seemingly live her life for her children rather than being able to live her life for herself. And you see that with traumatized people in clinical settings, that they're the one that everyone else pours their problems out to, but actually aren't incapable of fulfilling their own agenda. So they're the sort of things that be in the background as I would carry out, in a way that she felt comfortable with a diagnostic interview that was interspersed with establishing of rapport, the sort of things that Michelle was talking about. And that may, so there are some aspects of history and some aspects of assessment that you may never get to. There are some people who will never fill in a questionnaire. You know, they've been traumatized in institutions where questionnaires usually meant bad news.
Good point.
Thanks, Warwick. And I know that you had a question also about boundaries, which I suppose is parallel to what we're talking about. But for Tanya herself, she may have been brought up in a boundaryless kind of environment, and that has particular implications for therapy. So I wondered if you wanted to discuss that or ask Michelle.
I'll ask Michelle. Michelle's a good one to ask this. I mean, people in a complex trauma spectrum have been brought up frequently in boundaryless environments, and because they never experienced boundaries growing up, you know, they have a lot of difficulty in actually deducing what a boundary is, and in therapy that can be quite challenging for professionals. And the question I would pose to Michelle is, you know, at what point does someone's boundaryless behaviours mean that they become untreatable?
Well, I wouldn't. I'd be not thinking about it as they're untreatable, but this treatment relationship being unworkable for us. And I think it's unworkable as soon as one person feels unsafe, that it's not tenable. So safety, mutual safety is really important for us both. So if I'm feeling unsafe, then it needs to be attended to. So I've been thinking more about boundaries as something that we negotiate from the beginning, and you model that negotiation of safe boundaries right from the beginning of the relationship rather than see them as barriers. I'm taking, I think it's Elaine DePore's words about we know you breach boundaries. It's about confessing it and being aware of where the boundaries do start to slip, and being aware, mindful for yourself, where the boundarylessness starts to kind of affect you in the relationship, and reattend to them so that they're mutually safe and negotiated. I hope that kind of answers your question. I guess I just came back to the concept of mutual safety.
Can I follow that up or not?
Yes, please.
Yeah. Can you? I mean, what might be of interest, particularly to our colleagues, is can you think of scenarios where, in your treatment of someone in this spectrum, where boundary issues made the ongoing continuation of therapy undesirable or impossible?
I can remember hearing in a supervision of somebody where they felt they were being watched and stalked outside of the clinical rooms, and that was just an example I can think of. That's a very blatant example.
Michelle, you were...
Yeah, no, see that. I was thinking, I haven't experienced it. I think that's partially luck, where it's been untenable in this context. It may become untenable for the other person, and I haven't been aware of that and haven't seen them, so I have to acknowledge that. But from my own perspective, I tend not to set up a lot of requirements of how frequently people need to be here for this to be therapy. So for some people, actually monthly is all they can tolerate, at least initially. And for some people, it's been, you know, on and off over a couple of years before they've come back and said, okay, I'm in for something a bit more intense and a bit more ongoing. So kind of letting the person kind of also sort of drive how close is too close until I feel close enough to do some of the other work.
I wonder too, Warwick, this is Jo, if there's something inside us that is sensing it as well, when responsibility is not sitting clearly for things like affect regulation and even simple things like keeping bookings of appointments and the timing of the appointment and so on. I think there's some very subtle things with boundaries that, again, are needed with a vigilance in this area. And I guess inside myself, I'm watching for that sense that somehow the responsibility has shifted to it being my problem, rather than me collaborating with somebody about a problem that they have experienced. I don't know what you think of that framework.
Who are you asking, Johanna?
I was responding to Warwick there.
Yeah,
Warwick.
Yeah. I think it's interesting when we're now talking to Johanna and Michelle that collectively I don't get the impression that there have been a lot of people that they've met in the complex trauma field that have actually necessitated the termination of therapy. And yet it's easy to listen to some people's perspective. You'd think that this was a major issue, or that there were multitudinous untreatable borderlines out there, if they use their terminology, that makes life impossible, and that we would all live in this hellish environment of lashing and people stalking us and breaking into our houses and doing all sorts of things. Yes, I mean in quite a number of years in this field, I've very occasionally, in a very careful way, had to desist with therapy with a very small number of individuals. But I think Michelle makes the point that from the first moment of the first session, you're frequently demonstrating sound boundaries. And I'll just give you an example. I can remember 19 years ago, a very, very traumatized person arriving with her multimillionaire father and impressive mother, and she had a history of severe dissociation, self-mutilation, suicide attempts, etc., etc. And they arrived at my office, she in tow with the parents ahead of her. And, you know, he's an articulate, impressive, powerful man. And he said, and the first thing he said as he came in the door, he said, "Doctor, before you see her, we would like a word with you first." And I threw them out. And that was actually very helpful. She never forgot that. But if I had let them come in and put usurped her position, and you know, there would have been no way that we would ever go anywhere.
Thanks, Warwick. Look, while I've got the two doctors online, there's been some questions in the the general chat room from participants, of whom there have been up to 760, about the use of praxisin. And it's something I only recently came across as well. So maybe, Warwick, do you want to speak about that first?
No.
Okay. Johanna, do you have any experience with it?
I didn't quite hear you. What did you say?
It's praxisin, praxisin.
No.
It's a cardiovascular medication.
No. I haven't used it.
Warwick, I know you don't want to talk about it. Do you know anything about it?
Look, it's certainly mentioned, but just about every drug known to man is mentioned at some time in the context of trauma, you know, whether it's an hallucinogens, whether it's opiates, and there'll be a paper somewhere, there always is, that trialed them in some group or other. But can I just make the point, I've never found any medication that solves complex trauma. That at best, you're getting some symptomatic relief, you know, from some portion of the effects of the trauma, but you're not in any way processing or resolving the underlying issue. And frequently, you know, early on, you're dealing with matters of basic safety, like the man that I just described, who came in ahead of the patient. I mean, he was an ongoing abuser. You know, giving her praxisin or any other medication is not going to solve that. Yes, there are people in this complex trauma spectrum, you know, almost invariably suffer with dysphoria, and in some it becomes more profoundly depressive in nature, and some have some response, not massive, to antidepressants. Some get some relief from intrusive voices or being triggered by, you know, taking small or moderate doses of major tranquilizers. Some, because of their major sleep problems, have, you know, take sedatives to help them sleep. But none of those in themselves are actually a primary treatment of their underlying complex disorder.
Thank you. Look, I think I'd like to just go back to Michelle. There's some questions coming in from the participants. In fact, I think everyone would have a comment, but we'll go to Michelle first. Just regarding the particular kinds of therapy that therapeutic approaches that you might use, or theoretical models. So there's been discussions about acceptance and commitment therapy, or exposure therapy, or CBT. How do you approach what you use with a particular client, Michelle?
I guess I'm thinking about the skills and the assistance they're needing, and which of these therapeutic kind of approaches are going to be a good fit for them. So if they've had prior experience, what was helpful, what wasn't helpful, is a really good starting point. People have developed an aversion to "don't CBT me," or, I mean, mind you, some CBT strategies I actually think are quite helpful, helping people manage the moment. But I would be led by what the person's prior good and bad experience or expectations are. Their own ideas about how change is going to occur, so their theory of change, I'd be relying on that for direction as well. And I think probably rather than adhering to a particular therapeutic approach, to be using principles, some of the principles of ACT, I can see that coming up on the chat quite a bit, I think are really useful, the acceptance of internal experience, so sitting with a learning to tolerate internal experience. So some of those principles are also within a DBT approach. But I think for people with complex trauma, I think being transparent about what I'm offering and a collaborative approach to, is this helpful for you? How is that working? And not to insist that a person fits a model of treatment because the evidence says they should.
And Dragan, I wondered if you wanted to comment on that from the perspective of being both a consumer advocate and a therapist. How would you approach that question? Dragan?
I can't hear him.
I think he might still be on mute, Dragan.
He's trying redialing, Mary.
Okay, sure. Johanna, did you want to comment on that one? Because I think it is quite important.
I missed the flow of what you were saying, Mary.
Yeah, just really about particular therapeutic approaches, because I think we've been talking about a general approach of being trauma-informed, which is really about the relationship and how we approach the interpersonal aspects of the relationship. But are there any particular therapeutic approaches that you think have particular value or, in fact, that you shouldn't use?
Well, I guess my overarching thing is, again, around relationship. I can't say it loudly enough, and I think, you know, the literature is starting to really shout it as well, that it's more important than any particular technique. But at the same time, I think with dissociation, it's really important to notice our bodies in space and for grounding to be part of what's offered and taught and becomes something that people have a competence in, and sensing their bodies and not being disconnected from their bodies, and using their bodies to calm them and bring them into the present, where usually, you know, often they are in not an unsafe place. And I guess interpersonal therapy would be my key mode of therapy, but of course there are other forms of therapy that have been shown to make good effect in this area, and once again I think it's not so much the technique but the people involved and how respect and safety and boundaries etc. are being communicated.
And Johanna, there was another question earlier on which I'd like to address to you. If you were a GP that didn't have the same experience with complex trauma and training, and possibly even the appointment structure that you have for longer consultations, how would you make the decision about when to refer somebody like this, and how would you know who to refer to?
That is tricky, and there's been a number of comments in the chat box about the limitations of 10 sessions for this group of people. I agree with some of what Dragan said, that those 10 sessions can be used to good effect, and that the goal initially is stabilising. And, you know, for some people, their local GP is actually the best person to do that, because they've had long-standing relationship with them and it is a place where they can be learning some stability and settling. But for others, there's a need to ask for more help in that area. And there are lists of trauma-informed and trauma-specific counsellors available through ASCA, the Adult Surviving Child Abuse National Organisation. And I would encourage people to get to know the people in their neighbourhood. And again, Mental Health Professionals Network can help with that, if with connections to people who have had training in the area of trauma. And for those who have a particular interest, I'd encourage them to pursue that interest with their own learning so that their practice can be more trauma-informed. There's lots of opportunities now in our learning community to learn about the latest in the treatment in this area.
Thank you. Now, can I just check, Dragan, are you back yet?
Yep, I'm here.
Great. Look, I just wondered if you wanted to comment on the question about who ought to be involved and how you make the decisions about when to refer and how to choose appropriate clinicians. Or, in fact, other support people as well.
Sorry, say it again. Who?
Yeah, look, how would you like your, say, your GP to choose who to refer you to and who to involve?
It says I'm off. Oh yeah, here I am. Okay, so well, I guess initially it's always collaboration, isn't it? So it's asking me, the consumer, who I want to be connected into, what services are going to be most useful for me, or what people it's going to be most useful for me to get connected into. You know, I mean, again, it's that instead of doing two, it's getting alongside, because Even in that initial experience, I can either have an experience where I have some sense of choice, or I have some sense of even a very small amount of empowerment, or I can just be in another situation where a professional is just telling me what to do and doing to me, and that's just going to be same old, same old. So I would always be wanting someone to ask me. I find that consumers actually do have a good idea of what they want often, even when they may initially say, I don't know. I find that with a bit of patience and just asking, that people do know what they need, they know what they're looking for. I'm not sure what else I can really say to that.
No, I think that's it's really important. So I think it came back to what Michelle said really a lot earlier about not doing things to people,
yeah,
but about working together and making sure that the person themselves actually has the power about a lot of those decisions at the same time as feeling taken care of. Michelle, are you happy to just come in and comment further on that one, just about collaboration and how to make those decisions?
Yeah, I'm just noticing comments coming up about teaching people things, and I've always been ambivalent about teaching people things, so I think we might be able to offer some information and offer strategies that appear to have been successful or helpful for others, but I think it's a different stance of offering it. It doesn't diminish your expertise, but I think teaching can very much feel like a doing too, so to take care around how we offer information about strategies, therapies, and psychoeducation, otherwise known as just good sound information about stuff.
Yeah, because it's very much, as Warwick's saying, there's not even a medication, you know, there's no one medication that works, there's no one therapy that works, there's no one approach that works, so we can't come from, you know, the place of, wow, you've got to go and do EMDR, you've got to go and do DBT, this will help you, this is what you need. We've got to come from that place of, okay, here are some options, here are some things that might be useful, here are some people I can connect you to. What do you feel is going to be most useful in that? And giving people the knowledge, if you like, that they can try different things. You don't have to go to one therapist and then that's it. You know, you can try different things. You can find the recovery path that's going to work for you.
Mm. And the very act of being able to make a choice and being supported to make choices, I think, is probably more important than exactly, you know, what you choose. Yeah, absolutely, I agree.
And look, all on that note, all of the resources that people have discussed tonight and even the things that have come up through the chat box will be available on the website afterwards. And for those who've had technical problems, the webinar is available as a download later on. You can watch it online. Or if you want to suggest it to other people as a resource. I guess what's been coming up time and time again is about the actual relationships and helping people to be empowered. I wondered if either Michelle or Dragan, since I have you both on camera, if either of you have got any particular online resources. I'm aware that we've got a lot of rural practitioners and a lot of times the kinds of expertise that you guys have is just not available where our participants are living and where their clients live. So what, you know, are there online or telephone resources that either of you would consider really useful?
I guess, it's already been mentioned, I think Joanna said, but I'd certainly be pointing people towards ASCA. They've got their website, resources up and running now. So there's tabs there on finding out various things about complex trauma. There's webinars on there. There's a whole range of stuff for professionals. The 1300 line is a support for survivors as well as actually for health professionals. So, you know, in an area you could ring up and say, do you have a complex trauma therapist in this area? And the person, the counsellor on the end of the line will be able to have a look on the database, see who's around. We're also getting organisations up on the database that are trauma-informed as an organisation. So I guess I would probably start there as a resource for people.
Thank you. And look, we're just really winding up now. So Dragan, while you're there, I just wondered if there was a couple of things that you wanted to say quickly just to finish up, and then I'll pass on to the others as well.
I think the two main things that have been coming out loud and clear and that people have sort of been discussing a lot as well is that it's all about relationship, building the relationship, and it's about hope, that it's holding hope that people can and do recover.
Thanks so much, Dragan, for your participation. Michelle, a couple of things that you'd like to finish with?
I think what keeps me buoyant in doing this work also is that being appreciative of how amazing people are. People do amazing things. They find amazing ways through to recovery and constantly surprise me, as well as, you know, being saddened by the terrible things that people do to each other. But ultimately, whatever therapy you're doing, people are relearning that other people can be trusted and other people can be safe and are safe resources. So whatever else you're doing, I think that's central.
And I think that's so valuable when we have practitioners from so many different disciplines online as well, that it's the relationship and providing someone who can be trusted. Thanks so much, Michelle. Johanna?
I just wanted to thank everybody for being online. Your presence, listening and making trauma something that you want to be informed about gives me hope for our system. And just for fulfillment a little bit of what Warwick's been noticing, that trauma's allowed into our conversations more than it ever was. And I guess just again that sense that we are our instruments in this process, and we need to look after ourselves in how we experience the emotions that we meet each day in the room around this topic. And a real encouragement to watch for the quieter ones than Tanya, who don't want to cause any trouble and don't make a fuss at the front desk, but who are hurting just as much as she is.
Thanks, Johanna. And Warwick, certainly not least, I just wondered if you'd like to just sum up for us what you'd like people to take away.
Yes, I'd like people to take away the collegiate nature of so much of the very difficult work you and we do. And I'd like to just emphasise that getting together on webinars is an incredibly healthy thing to do in a multidisciplinary way. And it's also very helpful to avail yourselves of the various professional societies that have long-standing close interest in the sorts of work that we've briefly touched on here tonight, and there are a number of both local and international societies, some professional, some consumer orientated, that have a great deal to offer. I'll finally just say, if anyone wants to make contact with me, and if they want any of the instruments I briefly referred to, any of the papers that I've alluded to, just send me an email, and most happy to do that.
Thanks so much, Warwick, and those resources from tonight will be available on the website a few days after the webinar as well. So I'd just like to thank all of our panellists for your expertise and the way in which you've been able to just so usefully and helpfully discuss these things with each other for the audience to see, you know, genuine collaboration in action. And I just think it's been a really valuable evening. I need to really apologise if the technological problems at my end have had an adverse effect for the participants. I've just had quite a few issues with a number of things tonight, so hopefully it still flowed smoothly enough for you. So thanks again for coming, and please make sure that you complete the exit survey before you log out. You do need to do that to get a certificate of attendance if you need CPD points for your participation. You'll be sent a link to the online resources within a couple of days. And this was the second in a series of three webinars. The first one was aimed at general practitioners, but I believe is now available on the website, but the live audience was GP. And the third and final webinar in the series will be held on the 11th of June, and that's actually about the therapeutic process. So tonight was a bit more about assessment, and next time is more about therapy for those people who had those questions. So, look, I'd like to just thank you once again for coming. I encourage you to complete the exit survey, and there's more information just there about MHPN's other activities, including local networks. So once again, thank you all very much, and we hope to see you again at another MHPN webinar, hopefully the next one on the 11th of June.